Hello, Student of Dynamics. This is Dr. Dan Baker with a first lecture in a brand new chapter. Still talking about rigid body kinetics here in engineering mechanics dynamics, but we're going to start a new approach. Instead of using our Newtonian F equals MA and M equals I alpha, we're now going to use work and energy. Okay, so this is the same progression we went through for particles, three different topics in kinetics, Newtonian approach, work-energy approach, and also impulse and momentum. Now, you'll remember from particles that the primary shifts from Newtonian into work-energy was two things. One of them is that work-energy is a velocity-based approach. That makes life a little bit simpler instead of being acceleration-based. And the second thing is that is it a scalar-based approach versus a vector approach? Okay, so scalar approach means that we can't split out our overall vector equation into two equations. We just have our one general work equation. Okay, so let's start out by reviewing what we know about particles. So for particles, so we know from particles that work and energy balance. We can write that in an equation that E1, which is the total mechanical energy initial, plus W prime from 1 to 2, which is our external work between position 1 and position 2, is equal to our final mechanical energy. Okay, let me go ahead and write out the definitions for those. So we said E is defined as the mechanical energy, which is essentially the energy from velocity and springs and height. Includes those three terms. And then our W prime from 1 to 2 is defined as our external work, between position 1 and position 2, or just position 1 and 2. Another way we can think of this total mechanical work is that this is the work exclusive of terms in E. Okay, so it turns out that for both springs and also height, which is gravitational potential energy, we could express those as work terms. Now, just a quick reminder here, as we talk about what is work, we can say that work is a scalar quantity, which is the product of a force vector and a distance vector. Okay, so we could express spring energy as spring work or gravitational work as gravitational potential energy. I've chosen to go ahead and leave springs and height in my energy term, and that we'll just deal with the external work over in the other term. All right, so those are things that are true about particles. Conveniently, this is also true for rigid bodies. Now, I will make a couple of quick modifications to some of the individual equations on the inside, but the fundamental equation for our conservation of work and energy, right? It's not just conservation of energy, that's when you don't have any external work, is going to be true for both particles and also rigid bodies. Okay, so our modifications for rigid bodies. Two items here. One of them is that we need to include additional work terms in our external work. So our W prime from 1 to 2 must include both force plus moment work. You should recall that the transition from particles to rigid bodies really is a transition to add in two things. One of those things is to add in rotation, and the second one is to add in the fact that mass is distributed over an area. Okay, so essentially bringing in our mass, moment of inertia term. So specifically related to our external work term, we can have a work from a force, which we can write as either the most general form, F dot R, or if we happen to have a position variable force, we could integrate our F force dot dr. Okay, and that's going to be integrated from basically position 1 to position 2. Now we can also have the work of a moment. For those of you that remember virtual work from statics, maybe you remember that we had a virtual work term for the moment, which we could write as our moment times our angular displacement, theta 2 minus theta 1. Now, there's an important note to make here about these angles. These must be in radians. Not degrees, but radians. Radians are the true measurement of angles. So this could also be written equal to an integral if you had a position variable moment. So an integral from theta 1 to theta 2, still in radians, of our moment d theta. Now conveniently, it turns out that the units from both of these work terms end up being the same. The top one here, we have a Newton meter. The bottom one, when we multiply a moment, so we're assuming we're in SI units, which is a Newton meter, times a radian. Radians are the ghost unit item, right? So they actually don't have a unit. They're actually a ratio of distances. And so this also has a unit of a Newton meter. And so conveniently, we can combine these two into a single equation as our total external work, work from both our moment as well as our force. So the second item that is different about rigid bodies is dealing with the kinetic energy. And now we must include both translational and rotational energy. And so as we think about translational energy, of course, that's going to relate to our standard term, which is that the KE, we'll call this KE trans for now, translational is equal to 1/2 mv squared. Now, the only modification that we'll make to put this into a rigid body context is this is going to be typically the velocity of the centroid. Okay. And then for rotational kinetic energy, so KE rotational, it turns out to have a very, very similar form. And that similar form is that it is going to be 1/2. Now, if mass is the scalar quantity, which essentially scales the amount of energy given by velocity, it turns out the scalar quantity for rotational is the mass moment of inertia. Okay, and so this would be I bar, moment of inertia about the centroid, times my angular velocity squared. Now, also conveniently, these have exactly the same units. Once again, we could look at SI units. And so in SI units, we would see that for translational, we have a mass, call that in kilograms, times a velocity squared. So a meters squared divided by seconds squared. And also then moving over to our rotational, we have our mass moment inertia, which is in mass kg times length squared, and then we have omega squared, right, which is in radians per second, and we're going to square that whole term. Keep in mind, radians is the ghost unit, it's going to go away, And so we're left with a 1 over seconds squared. I think you can see that's the same thing. Kilogram meter squared divided by second squared. Furthermore, we can prove that this is actually also equal to a Newton meter. If I just cluster this a little bit differently, a kilogram meter per second squared times a distance. I think you'll recognize that a kilogram meter per second squared is a Newton. And so it turns out that our kinetic energy is also equal to our work term, which is good because we're going to put them in the same equation. Okay, so the working equations for this topic is if we want, we actually have two different equations we can use. So if we want to find our kinetic energy about the centroid, we can say that Ke sub g is equal to 1/2 mv bar squared plus 1/2 I bar omega squared. And if we want to find our kinetic energy about either an instantaneous center of zero velocity, I'll list that as an IC, or a fixed axis, that it is equal to 1/2. And we actually here can just insert the mass moment inertia about that fixed axis or IC point. So doing the parallel axis theorem, transfer I bar plus my m r squared of g, which is the centroid relative to my IC. So the IC covers essentially whether it's a fixed axis or an IC, because all fixed axes are instantaneous centers of zero velocity. And this is going to be times omega squared. So this whole term here, as I mentioned, is my I sub IC, my mass moment of inertia about my instantaneous center of zero velocity. So there are some other points on a body you could take your kinetic energy about, but quite honestly, they just get more complicated. And so I think it's usually best to stick with either the centroid or the IC. Now, the reason that I like these two points is it turns out that they both have the same value. So the kinetic energy for the centroid and the ICZV have the same numeric value. So if you happen to choose your centroid for your initial and your IC for your final, it turns out that it would work out okay. But often we like to pick the same point on either side of the equation. Now, when I talk about either side of the equation, I'll go ahead and set up that full work energy equation with all the different rigid body terms here next. So bringing it all together, we find that, now leave a little bit of room to the left. I'm going to put it in now. We're going to put a summation out here, and I'll talk about that as I move forward. But we can have our gravitational potential energy, MGH1, plus our initial spring energy, 1/2 K times delta 1 squared, plus our initial kinetic energy, both terms of it, 1/2 mv1 bar squared plus 1/2 I bar omega 1 squared. Okay, so that's all of our initial kinetic energy plus our work that happens between position 1 and position 2. Now, like I said, I'll get back to this summation, but let's just put it out front there for now. So the summation of the work of our forces plus the work of our moments and this is going to be equal to, moving to the right side of the equation, a summation of my final energy terms, MGH2 plus 1/2 K delta 2 squared plus my kinetic energy terms, 1/2 MV2 squared. Let's go ahead and make that V bar about the centroid, plus 1/2 I bar omega 2 squared. So let me just put a couple notes associated with this. So we said that this whole piece here is my E1, my initial mechanical energy. This piece right here is my W prime from 1 to 2. And then the bottom piece here is my E2, my final kinetic energy. Let's go ahead and put a box around that, because that is a good working equation that you can use to solve your problems with. And then just a couple of quick notes. One of those, if you're wondering what is this summation, this is for a multi-body system. Now, it's actually your choice whether you write kinetic energy equations for each body in a system. Now, the challenge with that is that you need to add in some external work terms associated with the interaction forces between those bodies. But if you lump everything together into a single equation, then essentially you just need to add in the energy from each of those bodies, and you can neglect these external work forces because they're going to be equal and opposite on both bodies. And then one more note to make, the only directional term in this entire equation, again, right, even though we added in our rotational terms, all the rotational terms, we had omegas that were squared, the mass moment of inertia is not a directional term. Now keep in mind that our work terms, I guess there are a sum total of 4 directional terms. These work terms are directional if you have a force in the direction of displacement, it's positive. If you have a moment in the direction of angular displacement, it's going to be positive. But forces and moments counteracting the displacement will be negative. And the only other term that is directional is h. And so we can define our value of h as a distance above a chosen datum. So you can choose where you want to have h equal to 0. Make sure any distance above that is positive and below that is negative. So I hope that helps lay out kind of the fundamentals of work energy for rigid bodies. We will follow up this intro video with a couple of examples. So hopefully you see the application of this equation on different rigid body systems. Thanks for your attention today.